Hi, everyone, and thanks for coming to my talk. First and foremost, I'd like to thank PIXELvienna for inviting me. I was really inspired by the theme of this year, time to confess. So I thought, why not to do the same and confess? So these are confessions of an art director.
Actually, also asked around, and by around, I mean on Instagram, to understand what people wanted to know. So hopefully I'll answer some of those things. Now, before we dive in into that, let's give you a little introduction in case you don't know me or my works. So, who am I, right? So, I'm a freelance and art director from Portugal. Besides Portugal, I've already lived in Stockholm, London, and Toronto, but I'm currently back in Portugal working remotely from Porto, or, you know, really my hometown, which is about 40 minutes from the center of Porto. And you may ask, why did you come back? Obviously, because it's my home country. And then also, Porto looks pretty cool, right? It's obviously this isn't a sunny day. And also I tried all of these pictures online. No stock pictures. This is all taken by my phone camera. But no, it's just a really nice place to live most of the time. You have really good weather as well, good food, so what not to like. And again, if you ever come to Porto, please hit me up. Let's catch up. Now, you know where I live, but where have I worked? So I've worked previously full-time. I've been working for the industry for more than 10 years. I started as a full-time in studios like Mainframe, Featured Lux, Analog and Tendril. But I've been freelancing now since, I think, 2019. And I had the pleasure to work with even more studios and also clients like Microsoft, Nike, HP, Maxon, amongst others. And for example, with HP, I'm actually an ambassador for their Z by HP, which is also pretty cool experience and opportunity. Now, before I jump into all the confessions parts, I wanted to show my reel. I know it does need a little bit of a desperate update, and as it does show, you know, what's my style, what I do, and I think it'll give you a good glance of, you know, a bit of understanding of my style. So let's go for it. Confession number one, here we go. So, it took time and hard work to get where I am now. And yes, I know it sounds obvious, but I do get asked a lot. People do think that, you know, what you've seen in the previous reel, that's how I started out right away in the industry, which is not. And I do always like to point this out. You know, it's a progression. You get better over the years and the more work you do. So, here's my reel that I did as I was coming out of Hyper Island, and I was looking for internships, and I wanted to show this so then you can kind of see the difference and really understand what I'm talking about.
Some shoes and maybe take us for cola. We'll get you there and some.
Quite different from the previous one. Really testing a bit of everything. I had no clue what I liked. There was so much stuff to explore. So I was trying a bit of everything. I mean, I guess the particle state. I still do a few or a lot of particles. But, you know, as I went through the industry, I think that's when I really start understanding what I love doing. And that's kind of grew on it. Confession number two. And this one is an interesting one, or at least I think so. I still get nervous when I do talks. And this is true, 100%. But at the same time, I do also try my best to accept as much talks as I can to give back to the industry. I've learned so much from other talks, got inspired. And hopefully I'm doing the same. So let's talk a bit pre-COVID, right? I traveled a lot in 2019 because of conference. I did do a lot of conferences in 2019. And there were two reasons. One, I wanted to explore different cities. Again, pre-COVID, we would travel, right? Fun times. And, you know, so many beautiful cities out there. So great opportunity to just go even for a few days. And not only be surrounded by amazing and talented people and get to know new people, you also have time to explore the city. So that was one. And then second, my husband told me I should accept all of the invites. Obviously, it wasn't just accept at all. But as I was getting a few requests, my husband said, like, hey, it's time for you to give it a try, right? See what you like, if you like it or not. So I said, yeah, you are right. Let's do it. So this is the list of all the conferences I did in 2019, which is pretty much like, I think there's 7 in total, so that was a lot. And yeah, I was super nervous. Like, MUVO was the one in Prague was my first one. I'll call it my first real one. I had talked before, like, I've done some online interviews or podcasts, but, you know, really being in a stage in front of a lot of people that paid a ticket to go and see you, that was the first time. And I was really, really, really nervous. That's so that when I finished my talk, I went straight to get a drink. And when I mean a drink, I do say a hot chocolate, guys, not alcohol. It was very cold and I just wanted something warm, but, you know, and cozy. It was a dream come true. This was possible due to me being an ambassador by HP. They were one of the sponsors of the event. So they also wanted to allocate some talks, and they asked a few ambassadors if they wanted to give a talk. So that for me was also, again, a great experience. And then we have things like Motion Plus Design, Ars Electronica, you know, super interesting, amazing and talented people. And then we have IBC in Amsterdam, which that one was challenging in itself because it's way more technical. And I don't consider myself a technical person. So having to do a talk about techniques in Cine 4D or stuff like that was quite challenging. So, but I mean, good challenge. And then Adobe Max, again, this was for HP booth. And that was very interesting because we do works for HP, and we actually had done like a kind of like an installation there. So we were talking about that. So that was pretty cool. And then, I mean, one of the insane ones, I went to Melbourne, like Australia. That was so cool. I got invited to go to NodeFest. And if you actually see, Adobe Max and NodeFest were both in November. So I actually went from Portugal to LA and then LA straight to Australia. So that was intense in a good way, like intensely good. So yeah, so I've done 7 talks, and you'd think that by now I'll be super confident and not nervous. That's a lie. Always super, super nervous. But everything and all of them were so much fun. A lot of good memories. And even if, yes, every time I start a talk, every time I have to walk on that stage, which is probably one of the most nervousing parts, just like having all eyes on you, the more I start talking, the more I felt better. And above it all, I met so much amazing artists, so much amazing people that I've been a huge fan previously. I know, meet new artists. So yeah, I'm so thankful for having had opportunity for these experiences. Now, confession number 3, and this is probably one of very important one. I am a mother. I don't usually announce this to the world. I don't, you know, it's not like a, hi, my name is Nidia Dias and I'm a mother. But the thing is, when I was pregnant, I wasn't actually also announcing it. I was keeping it very to myself, obviously fans and family. But, you know, when people come and ask me for work, I'll just say, sorry, I'm busy. I didn't say I'm on maternity leave. I really don't know why. I guess I thought people would put me on the bottom of the list for freelancing. Not sure. But the funny thing as well is that 2019 was the year that I was pregnant, and it was the year that I traveled and did a lot of conference. So it was a full-on year, which was funny, traveling pregnant. Not, no, I'm kidding, it was actually fun. I got to skip the queues, which is pretty cool. And the reason I'm talking about this as well is because obviously now it's different, right? My life is different, and there's a lot of this balancing, you know, work and life, or outside work, which is, you know, quite of a new thing for me. But again, obviously this means in a way goodbye personal projects. And I'm talking about this because one thing that people ask me a lot is, can you please do more quick tips? Well, guys, here's the reason why it's been not many quick tips lately. I do love doing quick tips. And I again, this goes back to the kind of what I said when I was talking about the conferences, giving back to the industry. Same here. I started doing quick tips because I've learned so much from YouTube, Grayskull Gorilla, all those video co-pilot, you know, that was when I was starting and learning After Effects. So I'm trying to get back now, right? I learned so much from people that share their knowledge. So now I'm hoping to that by sharing my knowledge as well and things that I learned that people can also progress. And, you know, I'm still trying to balance and understand where to fit the time. No longer now I can really do it after work, because after work I'll go and play with my son. And then I'll probably too tired after he goes to sleep and I just want to watch a movie. But that's perfectly fine and that's perfectly normal. So I just need to balance it more, and maybe instead of going from one freelance project straight to another, just take some time in between and do those personal projects. And that's kind of what I'm trying to do actually now, this current month. But don't feel like discouraged, because my son is my personal project as well, right? It's just a different type of personal project. And I guess he's kind of called the pandemic baby. I mean, he was born about a month before the whole lockdowns and stuff like that. So, you know, you're in a lockdown, you have a baby, you have to stay creative, especially with a baby, right? So here's just a quick video, a little video of us having fun. Old one, but this is one of many. Confession number 4. But yeah, before diving in, and, you know, I'm just babbling here, I'm hoping you enjoy these confessions. I'm really trying to be as honest as I can about things. And if I do babble too much, I apologize in advance. But I'm really excited to be sharing all of these things. Now, I like to vary what I do. What does this mean? Well, I like designing. I love being an art director. And this year I also been dabbling in being a creative director. And what I mean by varying means that I don't tend to do one full year of freelance of just being an art director. I like to accept projects that I'm an art director, and maybe afterwards I'm the designer on another project. And the reason why, like, for example, designing, why I love designing, well, I love being hands-on, you know, crafting those style frames, that look. It's amazing, right, having that touch. But again, I think that the biggest thing that I do really love nowadays is, that definitely defines me, is an art director. You know, you're managing a team and you have to think of the concept from beginning to end, make sure that everything works out, and you have to delegate things to a team. So, you know, super fun, super interesting. And the thing with art direction is that you not always have the opportunity to be hands-on. Sometimes depending on the project you can, sometimes you can't. So that's, I think, is why I do always like to once in a while accept a design project, because then I'm hands-on. And then this year, like I said, I've been dabbling with creative director. I've been actually doing some creative direction for Tendril this year. And that's been super interesting, actually. I wasn't sure when I accepted it if I was going to like it. But I actually quite enjoyed it. It's, again, very different. Instead of focusing on one project, you have more than one project. And you have to make sure that whatever goes out of the door from the studio represents the studio, right? But at the same time that we're in line with the budget, we have the team that is perfect for the job, right, and all of that. So, you know, I love all of these positions, but obviously, you know, you're a designer, hands-on, but then you're always thinking, ah, wouldn't it be cool if I could, like, direct this piece? And then here you are, you're the art director. But again, you see all the team, your designer is doing these beautiful style frames. He's like, oh, I just want to go there and do it, but you may not have time. And then as a creative director, you have this whole ability of seeing like the foreseeing this whole, like, let's say, free projects and having these directors and communicating with them, bouncing ideas back and forth with them, and just really help them, you know, craft that path so they can be successful. And that as well is super interesting. But again, you're always going to miss something because you see them directing something and it's like, oh, if I can direct that project as well, right? So that's the thing, like, there's the grass is always green on the other side, right? But yeah, for me, I like keeping it. I like to say that I get bored really easily. So I, for me, keep on mixing between this type of positions really keeps things interesting for me. So that's what I try doing. Now, confession number 5, and this is probably one of the things that I get asked a lot. Do I draw? No, I am terrible at drawing. It is a fact. First, I'm better at writing than I am at drawing. At least it's a bit clearer. At least I can read my own writing, even if I write it fast. But I'm more of a concept person. I'm more of like a, let's call it like a mind mapping almost. I kind of just juggle ideas. If I'm in a brief with a client, I'm a bit more on the quiet side because I like to absorb everything and I take notes and my brain kind of fires up and starts thinking like, ooh, what about this as they're talking? And I take a lot of notes. And even when I'm concepting, I write ideas. Then I have, you know, drawings that I call them the thumb drawings. But they're all for my pleasure. And I mean, terrible perspective on that one. It's like, what is even that? And that one looks like it's on fire. It should definitely not be on fire, right? You know, it's. But the thing is as well, like, do you need to know how to draw? Well, hopefully I'm a proof that you kind of don't. The important thing is you need to be clearly communicating your idea and your vision to your team and to your client. If you can do that and people understand what you want from it, then that's what you should be aiming for. So for example, here's a project from Microsoft that I did, I think, end of last year. It was all about illustrating very abstract concepts. And what I mean concept is, it's how I think, right? When we're doing an advertising or, you know, a video, I'm thinking, what's the metaphor? What's the concept, right? Can I find little metaphors for parts of the story to tell that story? And this is a good example, right? This is all about finding that metaphor. One of the illustrations, and these were kind of abstract concepts that, you know, I had to illustrate for Microsoft. One of them was empower, right? Empowering. What is empowering? To give and promote growth, the ability to accomplish something, right? How do you portray that in a visually abstract way? So, you know, I explored a lot of ideas with the client back and forth on how to express this metaphor. And I kind of like this idea of growth or, you know, going up, you know, growing upwards, right? Or growing fully. So that's kind of the two frames that I did. One that you're kind of like starting out and growing. And then because of this, the way that we're doing this Microsoft things with the colors and the glass, I really love how the lights and the colors start coming, shining through on the image on the left side, right? It's like you're fully growing in something, you're getting empowered and growing as you do it. And the second image, the small one, was actually one of the first initial concepts where it was this idea of like leveling up, right? Like going your own path and growing it, like going pathing it. But I actually prefer then the simplicity of the left one. And talking about that, you know, finding the concept, finding the idea, doing drawings or not doing drawings, here's a project that was all about finding the concept and really, you know, having that exploration and space to explore different things rather than just going too crazy into like a specific look or drawing. So let's watch it first, see what it's all about, and then I'll dive in a bit of what was the behind thinking and how I didn't know to any drawing for it or any concepting, and I really wanted to keep it very broad. So Echoic is a music and sound design studio from the UK. They were celebrating 10 years and invited a few artists and studios as well to create ident for them. And this is their logo. This is, you know, it's an ident, right? They gave us their logo. And as I was looking at their logo, I didn't want the logo to just be an afterthought. I wanted to be part of the whole ident. And I start seeing that they use free shapes. Basic shapes, actually. So I thought that I wanted to explore a lot of different things. I didn't want to have a start to A to B. I wanted to be that kind of edit that it just is all about the editing. And, you know, because this, there are sound design studio, obviously they're going to make the music. I wanted the music to drive a lot of it. So my thought was, let me create, different tests that are all about circles, about lines, about triangles. But I also wanted to be graphic. So then I also wanted to have each one a bold color, you know, making a statement. And then obviously, you know, I'm a big fan of reference. Again, since I don't draw much, it's great to see, what other people have been doing, getting inspired. But also, this slide here is because I think that when you're looking on a project, you should always do research for a few things. One, check what style, right? It helps you develop the ideas that you want to create for that concept. But also, what has been done in that style? What has the client done before? What is their competitors have done, right? You don't want to be doing something that is very similar to what the competitor did, right? So research, referencing is always, always good. But here as well, I was really interested and curious to see how to bring these shapes to life in a very interesting way. And if you see here, here's an overview of the shots that I have in the video. And you can see that it's very, you have the blues, the reds, the yellows. I really wanted them to be graphical and bold. And then obviously I didn't want to be, here's a triangle, here's a circle. So I was playing with that idea of, you know, you have the circle on the last image on the blue, but they also made of small spheres. You have the line that is actually a line, and sometimes it's more, you know, maintaining more volume. Or the triangle where it's like smaller pieces, or you still have that shape. So it's really, really digging into the exploration. And that was the fun part of it. Some projects are a lot about the R&D. Some projects are much more about the full-on story and story beats. You just have to really be mindful when you get that brief, where and when you can use each other. Confession number 6. Sometimes it takes time to come up with a concept. And this is a good segue from finding a concept from the previous things I was talking about. You're not supposed to have ideas 24/7. I do have creative blocks all the time. It happens, you know. I wish I didn't. They do. They do happen. And I have an example for that. I had a brief for a shoe brand, and it was about representing the idea of comfort, right? This shoe was very comfortable. And they had some parameters. It needs to loop, and it needs to be in an environment. So I was like, okay, it seems fun. Like the concept, the idea of the comfort, representing it, but how can I do it? But I have to be an environment. And so it was kind of like in my mind, and I just couldn't figure it out. And I actually had a trip schedule in between, like presenting them my ideas. So I went to Montreal, and as I was there, still as well, you know, brain doesn't stop even if you're on holidays. And I was going around, like, oh, can't find any ideas. And all of a sudden, I see a bouncing castle. And then I was like, oh. And I was like, oh, this is so much fun. I mean, does it represent something comfortable? Maybe for kids, maybe not. But it's so much fun. And it's an environment. Like, I can use the bouncing castle in an environment. So I actually, you know, gave that idea to the client. And you know what? They really like it. But it took me a while to get there. You know, like, I was researching, seeing what other brands were doing. This own brand as well was already releasing these kind of loops because they're inviting different artists, seeing what everyone else is doing. And, you know, it happens. But I think at the end, I'm super happy with how this turned out. And I'm happy that I did that trip and saw some kids in a bouncy castle. So, yeah, creative blocks happen. Just try finding the best way to do it. You know, get out of the computer, go for a walk, go watch a movie. Sometimes, you know, it's needed. Confession number 7. And another one that I get asked a lot. How did I find my style? I didn't know I had a style. Well, I kind of do now. Now I know it, but not initially. I'll get some people like, oh, I love your style. It's like, you do? I have a style? But I guess what I understand is that I used to do a lot of personal projects to grow and to learn new techniques, new tools. When I was in my junior years, I really wanted to show the studio that, you know, I was growing and I could do this project and stuff like that. So I think I was just, you know, trying different techniques. And then as you're starting to do those things, you kind of start getting more interested in more things. And in my case, it was the abstract stuff. So I think that's kind of what it turned out to be, right? I just keep on exploring and like, oh, this is really interesting. And then that kind of became that path. So it wasn't planned, you know, it kind of just happened. And in that kind of my own style, I actually, luckily, and also for some reason, I don't know how that happened, but since last year, I think beginning of last year, I actually got clients and studios reaching out directly to me for my own style, rather than, hey, here's a brief and here's some references. Here's a brief. We like what you do. Can you do something for us? So ACO was one of them. It's a piece that I did for the Australian Chamber Orchestra. I did it with my husband. And this piece was done with Substance Studio. They were the ones kind of orchestrating the whole thing. And we had to obviously get inspired by the history of the music that we got for this piece. But ultimately, it was all about, you know, do your thing. And you know, I'm so happy that they liked it. It was such a really good experience. Microsoft Illustrations, again, you know, I was working directly with them last year, doing my type of illustrations, I guess. And so that was super fun. I was super lucky to, as well, an honor to have done one of the splash screens for Fino 4D. You know, it's always fun opening the software that you use and seeing your own splash screen. So that was pretty cool. Equic, I already showed. Again, there was a very open brief. It was so fun to just actually do R&D. 46 Day of Type, they come contacting me this year to do the letter E. So that was also interesting for me. I guess I'll consider that as well a personal project, right? So that was fun to try a few different things in X Particles, actually. And then the Living Systems. This was pretty cool. This was actually done with all the Z ambassadors. And I want to actually focus a little bit on this one because, you know, there's a lot of confessions, but I know people always love a little bit behind the scenes. So let's dive in. The Living System. So a story about energy, creation, interaction, and adaptive environments. So I'll show first the video so you can understand what I'm talking about this story. And then I'll explain a few things. So how did we come together for, you know, one idea? So we're 7 ambassadors, right? It needs to feel cohesive. We need to know, like, it needs to work. We didn't want it to be, oh, each one does his own part and then we just put it together, that's it. We want it to feel like a common thread. So each one of us actually initially wrote down ideas of what we wanted to do. And by this, I mean that, you know, they said, here, open brief to whatever you want. So each one of us decided to write down what they would like to work on. What was their idea? Like, what could this be? And then obviously we had plenty of Zoom calls, right? Because we all also lived in different time zones, different countries. So, you know, it was actually funny to try to match everyone's schedule into these kind of calls. But we start get each person, some got girlfriends, some start doing drawings, some went diving into some tests, and we're all trying to figure out what we wanted to do. And the funny thing is, I guess, when we actually started this project, I think we're all in lockdown everywhere. So I think all of us somehow felt that we wanted to do something related to nature. And this wasn't even us saying, let's do nature. It's like, as each one of us wrote down the ideas, and then we opened them, because we were doing them on a Google Slides, everyone was talking about nature. And I think it was how us humans relate to it, right? And how being inside the house and not being able to go out, I think all of us were desperate to, you know, get acquainted with nature. So this is a little bit of a collection of the mood boards of our ideas and references as we were, you know, going through these calls. And here is a little bit of that Google Slides that I was talking about, where we were kind of evolving it in each part of that was our own, and explaining, like in my case, I was explaining how I wanted, you know, to show nature, but through a different perspective, and how could that be? What that's that different perspective, and how that works. I was looking at references and things that I really wanted to do. Other people were doing drawings, like Alex Truchot. Some people were putting things from their tests that they're already working on 3D. Each person has their own way of starting. Now, again, this was also a very open brief, but one of the things is we need to challenge ourselves. We need to do something new. A technique, you know, use a new piece of software, something like that. Now, confession number 8. I feel the imposter syndrome a lot of times. Now, I know this is a very talked topic. I know a lot of people say this, and they do it because it is definitely true. We all feel it at some point in time, even a lot of times. I definitely felt it in this project. And why do I mean by this? Well, if you look at the structure of the video, how it was, this is the order, there's so many amazing artists. Like, it's insane. Like, I follow them for years, like before I were even ambassadors. And if you see, I'm right between, my section was right between G-Monk and Jody. I mean, G-Monk is like, dude, everyone knows G-Monk and his work. And, you know, I've followed his work for such a long time. And then we have Jody. She's a award-winning adventure sport and documentary photographer. Like, her work is insane. And she works for National Geographic. I was like, feel the pressure. I wanted to be as good as them, right? And so I felt imposter syndrome. Now, let me say it as well, like how nice everyone was to each other. There was no egos in this project, none at all. It was actually so much interesting and fun because none of us wanted to overstep the other one with opinions. So we all, at some point, we're always like, no, no, you can be first. No, you can do that section. No, no, you do that section first. It took us a while to come up with a structure because no one wanted to be like, oh, I want to do the end part. I want to do the beginning. So, you know, we're good that we had a producer actually with us. It's like, guys, we got to get a structure. And, you know, we also all helped each other. If someone had a doubt on something, we're all there, like, helping out whenever we could. And to make it a little bit more into perspective, this is kind of really the parts that each one of us done, so you can understand the styles. And G-Monk and Jody, the one that came before and after me on my part, they were both doing filming. So as we were developing our story and we were kind of working. And as I start seeing stuff from G-Monk, stuff from Jody, and they're doing so much filming, I was like, oh, I want to do some stuff too. I want to do some filming. But let's check first my part once again, because obviously I showed you the whole thing. And so this is a transition from G-Monk, because I had to do a transition from his scene to mine. And then I had to do one at the end from my stuff to Jody's stuff. And I actually started with mine to Jody because while we were talking, obviously, Jody was doing all drone footage, right? So I had to, really, I wanted to nail first those transitions, hers and G-Monk's, because I knew that in between I could pretty much do anything. But if I nail those, I'll be fine. And even with the transition to Jody was actually pretty cool because I told her, hey, I really want to try doing point clouds. And if you do some stuff with your drone, I can get the data out of it. So, you know, she was filming in US and then sending me stuff. I'm so happy. And she did such a good research to actually find the tree for me. I told her, if you don't find one, it's fine. Like, I can see you're now going mountain biking. I'll make it work. And she found this lovely, lonely tree in the middle of it. It was so cool. And all of this, I was like trying to match the colors with Gmunk. There was the rocky elements at the end, so I did the rock thing. So it's all about like trying to match as well what came with the rest of the video to really make it feel part as one. Now, how did I do this? This is actually one of my favorite shots in the whole thing, and I'm going to explain why. And then comes with confession number 9. Sometimes I have no clue what I'm doing. And why is this? So I said before, we really need to challenge ourselves, right? I wanted to try something different. And one of them I wanted to do is filming, because I knew that Gmunk and Jody were doing it. So I really want to have a bit of that in mind as well. So I set myself to do some filming, but on the abstract side, the things that I love most. So I saw this video that my husband showed me. There was a commercial that was done for, I believe, the iPhone, where these things that you see here was actually filmed with the iPhone. And then they also made a behind the scenes showing how this was all possible to do. So I was like, oh, that is great. Totally going to do that. Well, here's my test. And how does it look? It looks like crap. There's no focus. Where is those nice, you know, close-ups? I tried different lightings. I even tried my husband's phone, because I think it was the same iPhone as the ad. Nothing. It looks so different. It was crap. But I did not got discouraged. I had bought a lot of stuff extra, because I, you know, why not? I'm having so much fun. And one of them was glitter. So I was like, I'm just going to add glitter to this. So I believe I had glitter and some red coloring that I had at home. Mix it all. And it created this really cool, I was calling it the galaxy. Galaxy look, that's what I'm calling it. It looks like a little galaxy, little planets. And the thing is, it became even so much more interesting, because it became my own thing, right? Instead of being just oil and water and a macro shot that didn't turn out good, as you saw, I start adding stuff and I didn't got discouraged. And then I had a little, I think it was a fork that I would like swirl in the water and then take it fast and then just let it go into this rest position. Normal camera, no macro lens. And I was just having so much fun doing this. And I have so many really good material. And like I said, it's my favorite shot in the scene. It's not even done in 3D. So that was pretty cool. Just as we're wrapping this up, here's kind of what I did for this project. Again, I wanted to just explore things, right? This again, even if it was not a personal project per se, it did kind of felt like a personal project, because we can pretty much do whatever we wanted. I knew a lot of that I wanted to do was on the edit, you know, having picture on picture, nice transitions, match cuts. So I did a mood edit. So I got some things from the references that I got and things that I liked, used them as a reference, got some music bits that I can use for timing. And then I just start evolving from that, and you know, the evolution. And it's pretty cool to see like how even the transition at the end was working, right? How you went from just this kind of just dotted stuff to a more painterly look. So yeah, it was a really fun project to see how, you know, like even doing different tests with particles. Like some, I wanted one thing, and then I actually did some mistakes on one of my simulations. Actually came out better. So it was pretty cool. And then confession number 10, just because I like around a number of confessions. This is my last slide. I just needed this last one. Actually, this is my last slide. Thank you everyone so much for listening to me babble. I apologize a bit for my voice, a bit sick. No, winter is coming. If you have any questions, please let me know. And otherwise, follow me on Twitter, follow me on Instagram, go check my website. Email me afterwards if you want. I'm always happy to connect. Just say hi. Thank you very much.
And we're back with the Q&A with Nidia Dias. Welcome. Thank you so much for joining us here in the Q&A. We're looking at questions. We have one question right now. And I'll start you right off with the first question. Is that okay for you? Thank you so much for the talk. I forgot. Thank you again, because we've talked a little bit before the whole thing started. Okay, so I'm learning by myself for a year. Should I try to get an internship as soon as I have a portfolio, or take more time for personal projects? It's a question from Twitch, from Joshua Alina.
That's a tough one without seeing the work, but I feel like as a starting out, you'll never be confident, so it's always going to be hard to know when to send your stuff. So I feel like if you feel like you're getting progression for a year, and you put a website out or stuff like that, just try internships or places you like, because as an intern, people do know you're still learning, right? It's the best time to really join in the industry, because you can make a lot of mistakes, because that's what you're supposed to do. But I'm also more than happy if you'd like to, send me your stuff, and I can also let you know my opinion once I see your work. But I remember when I did my internship and I applied and I thought no one was going to answer, but I had to do it for school. So I did it, and it turned out good. So you just need to like try a few places. And sometimes it's fine as well to, if they don't reply, sometimes they're very busy. So, try later, 2 weeks later, just check in and stuff like that. Sometimes it's just the timing that you send that may have not been the perfect one.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. That's a good tip. a helpful tip, I think. Always remember that the people you're writing to may be busy, not really waiting for your portfolio to pop in. So just a nice reminder is not impolite. It's just asking again is okay. And sometimes people just forget, or emails get lost, or whatsoever. Okay, here's another one from Miatka, I hope I pronounced that right. How did you understand that this profession is yours? How did you get started? Why 3D? And thank you for the presentation. It was awesome.
I didn't know from the start that I even wanted to do design. I'm from a small town in Portugal. So when I was studying, if you think of arts, everything will be architectural other than sculpting, painting, more the traditional sense, which wasn't something that I thought was interesting to me. As you saw, I don't have very good drawing skills. So I was just very, in high school, I had no clue what I wanted to do. And I was a bit of a geek or a nerd. I used to buy these magazines for like software for PCs and stuff like that. And one of them came with a web designer trial. So I was like, this should be cool, like coding. But then I started getting more interested in actually designing the website and actually learning the coding part. So that's when I realized I wanted to do design. I started learning Photoshop and all the stuff at home. So I really just started first more in the graphic design sense, and that's when I took my course in university in Portugal, was in graphic design. But I think as I was learning more about the industry, I started seeing 2D animations in After Effects and thinking, then I want to do 2D animations. Would it be cool if my posters could be animated? And then I learned about Cine 4D. So that's kind of, I think, was always the curiosity, right? Seeing there's more and there's more of this. And then I was just trying, right? I tried After Effects and then I tried Cine 4D. And then I realized that I really liked it, the 3D side. And that's what I kind of pushed forward. So I think it was just progression, like starting with one thing and then realizing, ooh, you can do this as well. So it wasn't like a very straight path, but I think having the base of graphic design help me have the look that I have now in 3D.
Okay, thank you. Here's another question. What would your dream project or dream client look like? Who would you like to work for? Or what kind of project would you like to work on?
Tough one, tough. Well, I already have one, a dream client, which is HP, Ziva HP, because I'm an ambassador for them.
Mm-hmm.
That's actually pretty cool because usually they come to me with open briefs and it's like, do your thing.
Mm-hmm.
So that's like a dream job, right? If people just tell you, do your thing, and they trust me. So that's a really good one. I don't know. I think it's funny, but like kind of going back to what I said on the call that I get bored. I think now I want to try doing something different. Like I've been doing a lot of, you know, the Microsoft stuff, UI, and a lot of abstract stuff, but I miss, like, I remember when I started at Mainframe, I was doing a lot of like idents and, you know, like, things for broadcast, which I haven't done in years. Right. So I think shifting back to trying to doing something like that I haven't done in a while, like an ident for some TV show or program would be cool. I think I always wanted to do a title sequence. I did a little bit on the semi-permanent with Joyce, which was pretty cool. But I'd love to get, like, you know, someone being like, hey, we have this cool new movie coming out. Do you want to direct the title sequence? I think that's probably, like, it's always been on my bucket list. So probably that one.
Okay. Interesting. Yeah, reminds me of Erin Sarovsky, who she was here last year, and she does a lot of these, and they seem fun.
Yeah.
What tips do you have for people just starting out with motion design? Is there anything you would recommend for especially young people starting out? What kinds of tasks should they, you know, set themselves, maybe? Or is there any, you know, would you recommend to just start on a project or maybe do a little exercises? Is there any approach that you could recommend?
I think it's one of what I said. It's really, everyone knows you're coming out of school or university. It's, you know, we're not supposed to know everything. So it's fine. So don't be discouraged by that. And then second, for me, at least, I do love the idea of personal projects. Mm-hmm. Depending school from school, like when I was at Hyper, a lot of our projects was team-based, right? So at the end, when we all did our reel, they look very similar, right? So having personal projects in there mixed helped distinguish you from the rest of the class, right? Because when you're doing your own personal projects, you can really focus on what you want to do and your style.
Mm-hmm.
For me, that's very important. So even without being someone just starting in the industry, whenever I'm looking at portfolios, I do enjoy looking at personal projects. I remember when I started out, I had this thing that, oh, I need to have on my portfolio stuff for Nike, for MTV to be interesting. And you kind of start realizing that it doesn't really matter. It just matters what you're doing in terms of the art itself and the design. So if, you know, if it's a personal project, but it looks spot on, that's all that matters. I actually remember one of motion designer that used to work at Mainframe. He told me one time when I was starting out, he said, it's better to have 5 seconds, but they're amazing, than trying to do like a 30 second thing, but it's just rushing to have the whole story and not making the look, because 5 seconds is all it takes to get someone to love your work, right? To really see potential in you. So I think here it's the same. It's just don't get too caught up in doing like a personal project that is like a 30 second video if you don't have that time. Like make something short, make some stills, something that really showcases you. And I think that's what people want nowadays, is personality above it all.
Okay. That's a good tip, I think, for people to explore a little bit what they like, I think, which is also not so easy to, at least that's my experience with students. It's always hard to even find out what it is they like and love and what makes them, what shows a little bit of personality. What would you recommend to people looking to start freelancing who didn't work in big motion design studios yet? Do you have any tips for people starting out in freelance, and what are your maybe learnings in the field?
Yeah, for me, it took me a while to go freelance. I was always super scared to thinking that I would never get jobs. So it took me a while to take that plunge. For me, it was great prior to going to freelance to actually work at a studio, even if it's a short period, because it's so different to go straight from university to freelance than going from university to a studio, because you'll learn so much way faster in a studio working environment. And you learn as well, like, you know, file naming, all the structure, being organized, yeah. You know, all those things. Yeah. You need to be sure that you have those things, because it's at the end of the day, you know, like, you're working with a team. You're not just directly. If you're working directly to client, you know, you do your own structure. But every time you work with a studio, every studio has their own set of, like, things that they use, tools that they use, the way that they do things. So for me, it was very important to get that knowledge from working in a full-time. You gave me that, you know, how to work with a team, because I think that's important. But then as you starting in, as, like, I think it's, the classic, you make sure that you have money beforehand on your, before going full freelance, you know, that you have to cover, because when you're starting out, you know, you can start to work right away, but then you're not sending your invoice until, you know, you finish the project or end of the month. And then it still takes more time to get that invoice paid, right? So just, you know, the classic, make sure you have a bit on the side for that. And what I did is just, I created a list of places that I wanted to freelance. I prepped my reel, I prepped my portfolio, and then I just email people. Right? It's like I said, it's kind of like, if it feels weird, like, oh, here's a, it's not a cold email, because, you know, like, it's always good to tell them, like, make sure that you look at their work. And really understand what they do and what you like about that, and let them know, because that's that personal touch. And then, like, there's so many, like, nowadays, like, having a good Instagram is really just a good step into the world. You know, if you have good works, it helps right away getting, like, a lot of the freelance work. And then, more than anything, just stay humble. You know, like, everyone knows everyone. It's a small world. And then if you do great in one job, you're probably going to be recommended for other ones. So, you know, it's all about making sure that you, once you start with something, make sure that you keep that connection with them, and you're going to be recommended as once you start, you know, doing things, and people come back to you. They will definitely come back if you do a good job. So it's all about just hard working, really.
We have another question. Do you have a thriving creative community where you work? Do you have meetups? Kind of get-togethers, stuff like that. Is there a big community in Porto? Is that, I'm assuming this is where you stay where you're living at the moment?
Yeah, yes and no. Like, I came from places like London, at every corner you step into someone from a studio at the pub. So that was obviously different. We don't have that here, at least in Porto. But since I came back to Portugal to live here, me and a friend, we actually started like a Porto Motion meetup thing. And so we obviously, it was just right before the lockdown, so we were about like all excited, and then the lockdown came. But we started, created like a Slack channel where everyone can just share their things, projects, even questions. And then I think like about a month ago, we did our first like a physical meetup, which was pretty cool, like finally seeing people face to face. So yeah, so we're slowly trying to like, there's a lot of talent here. But Portugal is so small, right? And a lot of people don't live precisely on Porto, so we're all around Porto and all the stuff. So it was just nice to have like meet everyone, different backgrounds, and a lot of people as well, like me, I think, are coming back to Portugal. So it's a lot of talent coming back. So it's been fun too. Like, I remember when we created, I was like, tell my friend, if we have like five people, I'm happy. And I think we're like 40 now on the Slack channel. So I was like, I'm impressed. You know, slowly getting there. So slowly, but steady, getting there.
Okay, and do you feel like this intention of coming back do you think that the freelance world, especially now with, you know, remote work being getting more more of a thing, actually, because everyone needs to do it, and people are realizing that remote is possible. It's not ideal, of course, but it's somehow possible, and the physical closeness is not necessarily important all the time. You think that moves people to kind of come back to where they grew up and where they have good memories, or is that just a coincidence, or is it just Porto because it's so nice?
Yeah, just Porto. We're just coming because it's nice. No, I think it's a bit of both. Like, I came before the whole pandemic for the reason as well, because I was speaking of having a family, and it's always nice to have it closer to family, to your own family. But I feel like nowadays, it's even with studios that probably in the past would be a bit more, oh, we need to come to the studio to work from here. Mm-hmm. I think they realize that now they have to open up, right? And I think people in the pandemic, especially in bigger cities like probably London and New York, it's all of, those cities are mostly about, you know, the going out, right? You have so much stuff to do. The museums, the bars, all those gallery openings. Once you take that away, right, you're confined to a space that, you know, may not as be as nice as you can get at home, back home, right?
Yeah.
So I think that probably could have been one of the factors, right? Like even here in Portugal, most people now are looking for or a house instead of an apartment. Or if you're looking for an apartment, one with a veranda, or, you know, like, you just shift your perspective of what you want. Or a lot of people want to be close to nature or to the, you know, go to the beach or stuff like that. So they're kind of going a bit outside even the city center just because they want more of what they missed in the COVID time. I mean, we're still in the COVID times. But I think it's a mix. I think it definitely having as well the studios being more open to freelancing, I think that will help. Because it's, I think as well, there's so many talented people that never really were afraid to make that move to go to another country because it's a very big move. I've done it two times. And it's always scary, right? You're going to a place you don't know anyone, language and all this stuff. But they're so talented, right? So if they have the opportunity to work, like I'm always fascinated when I find people in Portugal that never left and have amazing work and work with like people all around the world. Like for me, when I was starting, I was like, oh, I need to get out to do that work. But you don't, right? That's the good thing now nowadays is that if you just push hard and work hard and, you know, like get your work to a good level, you're going to get noticed and then you can still be, you know, where you are and where you used to be and just doing these really good projects. So I think that's something really nice to like nowadays that you can do that.
Okay. And coming back to, you know, connecting with other people, how important do you think it is, especially for young people to, you know, do that, find other people with like-minded people, people with that share the same interest? How would you rank that in terms of how important it is for your personal development, for example? What do you think, how much of an impact has it had on your work?
I think immensely. I and the thing goes to me, I'd say like a lot of the projects that I work on, especially initially, was a lot about networking. Like not like I went to networking events, but it was just people that I met that we imagine went to work somewhere else. And then there's someone is looking for a designer, it's like, oh, have you checked this portfolio? So that as well helped me a lot. Like I've had projects where I remember putting on Twitter when I went freelance and then people like, oh, I just told my boss, like people that follow me, like we talked even online and they said, I just send your portfolio to my boss. So that helped me professionally, but then personally as well, like it's our community is so nice and humble, and it's so nice that if you have questions, if you have anything, like people just are there and answer, you know, if like I said, sometimes we're busy, but like I said, I keep on snoozing emails so I can reply to people, because it is true, like it's, you know, like the same way that people are asking me these questions and hopefully I can help. I had a lot of doubts as well, right? I've talked with people about rates, right? Or I'm going freelance, like, should I do a portfolio? You know, all those questions I've been there through, right? So if you have someone that has their experience that can help you and guide you, that will, instead of you being in doubt and maybe never pressing that send button for that email, right? Like someone will be like, hey, it's fine. You know, no one is going to be offended that you send them an email I'm looking for an internship, right?
Yeah.
So I think having people around you that have been through those things or in the same area, I think is always so nice. And it's very inspirational, right? Like talking with other people that understand your language as well. So that's also pretty cool.
Yeah, and I think those are the big advantages of, you know, going to a studio, being able to be close to people who have the same interests and also, you know, art schools. I mean, the point of art school is not necessarily just, you know, you can find, that's my personal view, right? But I think nowadays you can find any kind of information you can find in a tutorial or in a YouTube video. There's no, you know, things that you can't find online that, you know, people are always, and as you said, the industry is very full, you know, full of people who want to share their knowledge and pass it on and give it to other people. But I think the beauty of you know, having other people around you that share that same interest and share that same, you know, excitement about art is what makes it so beautiful. I mean, it's part of why we do what we do with this conference, is trying to get people together and share that experience and understand how it makes you better and stronger. And it's nothing to be, you know, everyone started somewhere. There's no, yeah, you know, yeah. No one I've met has ever been, you know, good all the way from the beginning, you know. I mean,
and now there's, like you said, with the tools, right? Like, now we have people coming out of university knowing Houdini, because that's the tool now. When I was learning, there was not even Redshift. Everything was like, you press a button and you wait to see it, and it's like, ah, the lighting is terrible. Try it again. You know, it's just like, so things evolve, and like people coming out of university are like knowing way better software than I do, right? Because you don't have that time to learn, like, fully just learn a software nowadays. You do it between projects. So there's always going to be something that the new younger generation comes in with a different perspective as well, right? And that hunger to, you know, thrive, which is always, I think, what pushes you forward, right? Mm. Like wanting to be better and doing great work. And yeah, you just have to keep on pushing for it. But we all started somewhere. Yeah, I definitely agree that. That's why I show my first reel, right? It's not, here I started right away doing this Microsoft and this kind of thing for us. Like, it didn't start like that. I was doing personal, and then to like an internship, and that gave me like the more professional jobs, right? The more like brands stuff, and then, you know, slowly from there. But yeah, it's a path, and sometimes it's ups and downs as always. But you know, you just as long as you're doing something that you enjoy, I think that's what matters at the end of the day.
Okay, here's a personal question, because I've been talking to some people lately, especially that and whenever you talk, you especially about the younger generation, you talk about how it's different for them, because so many things are available. The older generation, it feels like it was always a struggle to get to information. It was a struggle to find, to like even find something that somehow looked like the stuff you were interested in. Before Instagram and all these things happened, it was not easy finding the stuff, the interesting stuff. You know, now you just type something on Pinterest and it's so easily available. And I find it interesting, because it for me at least, it feels like something like that did not exist when I was younger, and my problem was not sorting out the bad information, it was just getting information in the first place. So I guess my question is, how do you feel about that? Is that something you envy, or is it something that you think is maybe makes it more difficult for them because they have so much?
Yeah, I think it's a blessing and a curse at the same time, because I feel like I think like last week I was telling my husband that I love libraries, because I think that's where I used to go to check, you know, the art books and all the stuff. Like, you didn't have any all the stuff online. I remember doing research, you know, for university, and having to go to the library to get books. Now you can find it all online, right? You don't even have to go to the library. I enjoy that, but obviously, like you said, it was hard to find more stuff, right? Because if your library doesn't have certain types of books, you know, especially like I'm talking about a library that is not just an art library, right? It's everything. So the part of the art side could be a bit shorter, and a lot of times it's a lot of architecture and stuff like that. But I think now the curse is that puts more pressure on people, because, you know, it's so easy to be like, you know, 16-year-old bio thing. It's like, oh, I'm 16-year-old, and it's like this cool, crazy 3D stuff. And you may look at it, it's like, oh my God, I'm 20-something and I'm not doing it, right? So I think it'll make you feel more pressure to have to post, for example, every day. You know, things that we didn't do in the past. I never, I didn't do like the everyday projects, because there was enough, like, now everyone feels like you need to do something, you need to always keep on posting. And I think that's a lot of added pressure there, that sometimes is unnecessary, right? It's, you don't have to post things every day. If you have a good concept, a good idea, just flush it out and then post it when it's ready. And I think, like I said, like, everyone is posting things, that I think is a curse, when you're starting, because you feel that pressure. And we didn't have that, right? We just did it for the pleasure, and then, you know, oh, I'm gonna put on Behance and then see what happens. Now I think with Instagram is all about, if you don't post, it's like you don't exist, right? And I think I remember having a friend of mine that, I mean, Facebook now is a very old thing, but on the old times, she closed her Facebook account, and then she, after a few months, she put it back because she said, oh, if I'm not on Facebook, people think I don't exist anymore. Okay. And I feel like that kind of goes into the Instagram, right? If you're not sharing stuff every day, what are you doing, people? But it's not like that, right? You can take time, and you should take time for doing your projects, right? The every day is good to like flesh your creativity. But then if you want to do something, you know, like with ideas, a concept behind, a storyline, that takes time, right? You need to do research. You need to like explore what concepts you want to go forward, what style you want of lighting, you know, and those things you need more than a day to do it. So I think, like I said, a blessing and a curse at the same time.
Yeah, that's a good way to put it. Yeah. I mean, for me, it feels like this, especially with technical stuff as well, it's now easy to find a solution on the internet, right? It's not, I used to own a book about Maya because I wanted to learn, and then I decided not to because the book was terrible, and it just, but that is how now I feel like who would even buy that? A book.
Yeah, I had one about lighting. I think there was one that everyone had.
Yeah.
It was like so old school. It was even like when I bought it was already even outdated.
Okay.
The thing is, but it was like everyone had it, that book. Like the students that I worked on, they all had that book, and I remember having it on. But yeah, it's the same. Yeah, it's like you have to do this. I was like, oh, I have to go through all this book to find like where.
Yeah, you have to read through the whole thing to find the stuff that you're looking for, and now you're just typing and saying, "Here's what I'm looking for." Yeah. Well, I'm going to see if there, I think there's one more question. What kind of change would you like to see in the industry to make life easier for parents?
Interesting. I don't know. I think I've been lucky enough with the studios that I've worked. I think it just gets harder when, if I'm working with a different time zone.
Okay.
But I think it's mainly making sure that what I understand is making sure that the people are aware that you're parents, that you have a kid, and telling them like I can work these hours, right? Like I can't, like if I have to get my kid from daycare at a specific time, I have to go and get him from daycare. So I think as long as you're open to it, you know, I think that's like first and foremost is like I'm a mother, I have a kid, it goes to daycare, my working times are this, and then hopefully those studios will understand. And like I said, the studios that I work with, they do, right? They know, and they just let me know. They just ask me what is your time? When do you work from when to when? And when can you not have meetings? And then I'll just tell them in advance, and then they know it, right? And I think that's it.
Mm.
We all have, you know, our things. And at the same time, like I'm happy sometimes. I say like if there's a client call at night, at my time that is at night, obviously it's once in a while, because they're in a different time zone, but I definitely try to do mine as well, because if he's at daycare, means that I can actually concentrate. If I have my son at home, that'll be a bit harder to concentrate. So it makes more sense that I do work when he's at daycare. So.
Okay. I think I'm looking at my crew to let me know how we are in time. They say, okay, so we have another 5 minutes. So I think you made a really interesting point there, and I think that's one of the experiences I've made is sometimes just stating the maybe not so obvious that you do not have all the time in the world, and just telling people how much time you are able to put into your work is important, and being straightforward with them and just telling them it's not, you know, I'm not working nights, I'm not working weekends, I'm not working this and that, is perfectly reasonable. It's not, it's...
And, like, and the thing is, like, people in that studio that you're working on, I'm sure at least someone there is a parent, right? So they will understand, right? And that's what I was saying in the talk, like in the conference, like at some point you're always thinking, oh, if I say that I'm a parent, they don't want to work with me. But that's not the case. I think we're just making this crazy ideas in our head. It's just as long as you're straightforward, you know, with them right away from the beginning, hey, this is the work hours I have because I have a kid. You know, that should be it.
Yeah, and it usually doesn't, I mean, it's just being straightforward and just telling them what is possible and what is not is not necessarily gonna, you know, make them stop working with you. It's just a matter of timing. And I think the more straightforward you are, the easier it gets for everyone to understand how that works. How is I'm going to ask if you know, especially with two freelancers, the way I see it, how does that work? Is it, do you guys need to really work out a mutual schedule or something like that? How do you approach stuff like that? Because I feel like you guys probably need to, you know. Share a calendar at least.
Yeah, I think the worst has been like calls, because we're in the same office. Like he my husband is like the desk next to me. So okay. I think the worst with the COVID has been like calls, because there's a lot of calls, especially when I'm directing or doing creative direction. I have a lot of calls. Mm-hmm. And then so I have to, me and my husband have to be like, which one of us and when goes to the living room to get the call and which one stays here in the office for that call. And then with our son, it's like, if one of us can know, oh, today I'm going to have a busy day. Like we'll do it day by day, like understanding, mm-hmm. oh, today is fine. Or, hey, I have a delivery today. So let's see how the day goes, but you may have to be the one getting Edward. So it's like, but it's so far it's been actually working quite good. I think because his job is more like focus, right? He does his thing. I'm the one that has a lot of calls. But also I think that we actually been like with the time zones when I'm working on imagine Canada, sometimes you're working with London. So our time zones, when we actually get calls and all the stuff, actually are a bit shifted. So he actually has been working quite good.
Okay. So that, you figured out a way to, because I sometimes feel like two freelancers is always a challenge in itself, you know, because there's so much option to shift stuff around. I mean, that's my experience as a freelancer has been, you know, to repeat what you said about the blessing and the curse, it's the same thing as a freelancer. You know, you can you have this freedom of, you know, choosing the time you work.
But now I have a kid, so there's that freedom.
That is, I'm kidding, it's out the window.
We have taken to the care. So okay. He wakes up. And that's it. I joke that he's our alarm clock now. So he's awake. And then we take him to daycare. So it's like our day starts. Actually, I'm more like, I used to be more like a night owl. I would love to work more at night. That doesn't work anymore. I have to be an early person now. Before having a kid, yes, I would sometimes like maybe work more later in the day, mm-hmm. especially if someone was like in US. And then probably the day after, then I'll sleep a bit longer because I was like, oh, I just finished late today. I'll adjust it tomorrow and I sleep a bit. Now, if I would work late tomorrow morning, I cannot sleep later because my son would not let me. So, yeah, so that's why I said in my case, now I have to really be like, I have to start at this time and be at this time. That's the time that I can really concentrate.
Okay, perfect. Well, I think that's a really nice way to end the Q&A. Thank you so much for sticking around. Maybe you can stick around a little more and check out if someone has more questions in the Discord channel. Thank you so much. We're excited to see, because I forgot to mention that Martin is on tomorrow and he will be talking about rigging. That's what... For everyone who was wondering why I was talking about your husband, that's the reason why. We're excited to meet him tomorrow. I hope to see you soon or talk to you soon. And
thanks for inviting me again.
Thank you.
It was a pleasure.
Thank you for a great talk. It was a pleasure having you. We will be showing Kate Gabriel's talk in just a bit. And unfortunately, as I said, she is sick. She won't be able to be here for a Q&A, but we'll send you off in the night with Kate Gabriel's talk, and hope to see you tomorrow. So good night, everyone, and have a great evening.